Like, I need another project. Today I'm straying from jet ski restoration to work on something a little bit more urgent. In case you missed it, Carson bought this VW Eos about a year ago. It had a broken timing chain and some bent valves, and we did some pretty major work on the top of it. Somehow we managed to get that car back together after sitting in the garage for like 3 months in pieces. That project was huge for Carson. He learned a bunch about engines, he developed enough confidence in his mechanical skills that he was actually able to take on like a control arm replacement and a wheel bearing and some other projects on the Eos all by himself. Ultimately though, he really wanted a car with a manual transmission. So we started looking around for something affordable. We found this 2003 350Z base model with a 6-speed manual transmission. Car had like 120,000 miles on it. Seemed to run great until it developed this crazy engine knock. After about a week, did I mention that part? Yeah, that was not good. He stopped driving it right away. We loaded it up on a flatbed and trucked it over to the shop. It took us a few hours to get the pan off the bottom for a good diagnosis. But once we did, it was pretty obvious what was wrong. At least one of the connecting rod bearings was damaged. You know what that means, time for a full rebuild. And what fun would it be to take on a project like that without filming it, right? I didn't capture everything for you, but I did bring my camera along so you can see what it takes to swap an engine in a car like a 350Z. It's not a detailed tutorial, but it's a peek at the process that might give you the confidence to take on a huge project like this. So how long does it take to swap a 350Z engine? The book says about 20 hours. Now for me, it was more like 25 hours. That's about 10 hours to pull the motor and strip it down and about 15 hours to put all the accessories back on and stick it back in the car. If you're paying a mechanic to do the job, you're looking at probably around $2,000 in labor. Yeah, that's what makes doing it yourself attractive if you have a couple weekends to do the work like we did. Now, I'm not a super organized person, but throughout this job, I had to be methodical about managing the hardware. The biggest problem we had with the Eos repair was figuring out where the bolts went after it sat for months disassembled. For this job, I bought a couple cheap plastic organizers, and as I pulled each component off the car, I placed the nuts and bolts for it in a compartment, and then I wrote the corresponding component name on the lid. Working from left to right, front to back, I laid out those parts in order so that when it came time to reinstall the engine, I could work backwards through the disassembly sequence, one compartment at a time. I'd like to take credit for that idea, but that's something that I learned from my mechanic. Which makes an important point. If you have crazy skills, a place to work, a killer set of tools, well, you might be able to remove an engine at home, but like me, if you have none of those, running a shop could be a good option for you. Where I live in Virginia Beach, we have a few choices for renting a workspace. I went with Rent-A-Lift in Norfolk, and that's because I like the chief mechanic there. Well, I love the chief mechanic there, really. When you rent a lift, you're not just getting a lift, you're getting tools and specialty tools. And most important of all, you're getting a coat. Jeremy is an ASC certified mechanic, and that guy is a lifesaver. I ran into a bunch of obstacles on this project. And yeah, I could probably figure them out eventually, but it is so much nicer to have a salty mechanic there to show you the right way to do something. Without Jeremy, this would have been just a huge, huge project. Oh, and speaking of help, Carson had every intention of being my wingman for the job. Unfortunately, he broke his arm and had surgery just before we started. He ended up hanging around the shop quite a bit, but 25 hours standing around when you can't help would drive anybody crazy. As you watch this video, pay close attention to the sequences where we move the engine and the transmission in and out. This is one step you don't want to do alone if you don't have to. For this project, Jeremy worked the engine hoist while I laid on the floor and guided the oil pan and the transmission through the tunnel and away from all the hard plumb lines. Carson saved up a few bucks and got a great deal on some new wheels and tires. We went ahead and worked those items into the schedule so that he rolled out of here with a pretty sweet looking ride. By the way, most shops will let you use the tire mounting equipment when you have a lift rented. Personally, I chickened out and paid the pros to avoid scratching those new alloy wheels. I'll try my hand at mounting rubber on steel wheels, but these new wheels are just way too nice to take the chance. I have to admit, we were both a little nervous when it came time to crank this thing. Carson did the honors, and thankfully it wasn't that exciting. If you want to see where we go next with this project, subscribe. Like always, thanks for watching.